Special Reports is a daily show that will cover issues surrounding the economic collapse. All our reports and daily alert news are backed up by source links. We work very hard to bring you the facts, and we research everything before presenting the report. Subscribe for latest on financial crisis, oil price, global economic collapse, dollar collapse, gold, silver, Bitcoin, global reset, new world order, economic collapse, economic news, political, geopolitical news. Today, we talk about China, Russia and Iran planning gold-backed currency. A Eurasian Golden Triangle is emerging with China, Russia and Iran as the three key points, F. William Engdahl notes. The latest Sino-Iranian rapprochement has prompted a lively debate regarding the new Eurasian world order. Sometimes profound tectonic shifts in the global politics arise from the least noticed events. Such is the situation with Iran and the recent visit to Tehran of China's President-elect Xi Jinping. What emerged from the talks confirms that the vital third leg of what will become a genuine Eurasian Golden Triangle, of nations committed to peaceful economic development, is now in place. American-German researcher, historian and strategic risk consultant F. William Engdahl writes in this article for New Eastern Outlook. Chinese President-elect Xi Jinping and his Iranian counterpart Hassan Rouhani signed almost 17 agreements on economic and technological cooperation. Furthermore, the leaders announced they will cooperate on the China-led One Belt One Road initiative. The researcher calls the formal inclusion of Iran into China's new economic Silk Road project a giant positive step. According to Engdahl, it will allow Tehran to break years of economic isolation and will open doors to the region's economic development. Pakistani columnist Afzal Hussain echoes Engdahl's stance. The lifting of economic sanctions from Iran provides trade opportunities for regional countries such as Pakistan, Afghanistan, China, Russia, and Central Asian countries, particularly Tajikistan. The trade activity will generate billions of dollars not only for oil-rich Iran, but also for the countries having close economic relations with Iran, Hussain noted in his article for The Nation, the Pakistani media outlet. Hussain views Pakistan as a geographical corridor between China and Iran. The China-Pakistan Economic Corridor (PEC) project has become more vital after latest trade accords between Iran and China, he underscored. The Pakistani columnist highlighted Russia's determining role in the region and expressed his confidence that China, Pakistan, Iran and Russia will bolster trade and economic growth in Central Asia and beyond. Referring to the fact that Iran currently has SCO observer status, Engdahl envisages that Iran will be formally admitted as a full member of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization (SCO) at their next annual meeting this summer. In contrast to those experts who regard the recent Sino-Iranian rapprochement as a potential apple of discord between Beijing and Moscow, the researcher points to the fact that the countries would rather create a mutually beneficial triple alliance, a future cornerstone of a unified Eurasia. We're seeing the emergence of a true Eurasian Golden Triangle with China, Russia and Iran as the three key points, Engdahl underscores. With a stated plan to route the Silk Road rail infrastructure to assist the mining of new gold for currency backing of the Eurasian member states, including now Iran with its significant own unexploited gold, the hyperinflated, debt-bloated dollar system is gaining a formidable positive alternative, one committed to peace and development. China embraces gold in advance of post-dollar era. To challenge the US dollar hegemony and increase its power in the global realm of finance, China has a potent gold strategy. Whilst the State Council is preparing itself for the inevitable decay of the current international monetary system, it has firmly embraced gold in its economy. With a staggering pace, the government has developed the Chinese domestic gold market, stimulated private gold accumulation and increased its official gold reserves in order to ensure financial stability and support the internationalization of the renminbi. The outbreak of the crisis and its spillover to the entire world reflect the inherent vulnerabilities and systemic risks in the existing international monetary system. The desirable goal of reforming the international monetary system, therefore, is to create an international reserve currency that is disconnected from individual nations and is able to remain stable in the long run. In the present zeitgeist, we find ourselves on the verge of a shift in the global monetary order. The shocks through the financial complex in 2008 that reaffirmed the innate fragility of the US dollar as the world reserve currency have sparked China to become a vocal proponent of de-Americanization, although its end goal is communicated less clearly. Being the second largest economy of the world, but relatively in arrears regarding physical gold reserves, China has a strong motive to surreptitiously work on its gold program until completion. For, if it would be candid in its gold ambitions, the price would significantly run higher, potentially disturbing financial markets and narrowing its window of opportunity to prepare for the next phase. State Council rapidly developed domestic gold market and stimulated private hoarding. China has been infatuated with gold for thousands of years. In the mainland, gold mining and use can be traced back to at least 4,000 years ago, and the metal has always represented economic strength and was regarded as the emperor's symbol of power. Although the Communist Party of China captured the monopoly in gold trade and heavily restricted private gold possession since 1949, in lockstep with the gradual liberalization and the ascent of the Chinese economy, the state started to develop the domestic gold market in the late 70s, which accelerated in 2002. A new page was turned when the Gold Armed Police started operating in 1979, not coincidentally a few years after the U.S. detached its dollar, the world reserve currency, from gold. This army division was initially assigned to gold mining exploration and has done so quite fruitfully. Since 1979, Chinese domestic mining output has grown 2,137% from an annual 20 tons to an estimated 467 tons in 2015. In 1982, the first steps were taken in reviving China's gold retail channels. For the first time since 1949, people were allowed to buy jewelry and the China Gold Coin Incorporation started issuing panda coins. The People's Bank of China, BOC, continued to be the primary gold dealer that fixed the price and controlled all supply flows. The real reform of the Chinese gold market was implemented on the 30th of October 2002 by the launch of the Shanghai Gold Exchange, erected to serve the full liberalization of the domestic gold market. From that date, the fixing of the gold price in China was transmitted from the BOC to the free market. In 2004, the State Council approved gold as an investment for individuals and the BOC slowly repealed control over supply flows. The Chinese gold market fiercely rose from its ashes. By 2007, the market was functioning as intended when nearly all gold supply and demand was flowing through the SGI System 6. A year later, in 2008, the Shanghai Futures Exchange launched a gold futures contract supplementing existing derivatives at the SGI. The Shanghai Gold Exchange, SGI, which is a subsidiary of the BOC, is the very core of the Chinese physical gold market. Its infrastructure provides a single liquid exchange overseen by the state, granting all participants a trusty venue that can be efficiently developed and monitored. The mechanics of the Chinese market incentivize nearly all supply and demand to connect within the SGI system. As a consequence, by the amount of gold withdrawn from the vault of the SGI, data that was published up until December 2015 in the Chinese Market Data Weekly reports, we could gauge Chinese wholesale gold demand. After the crisis in 2008, it became apparent in the higher echelons of the Chinese government that the development of the gold market and private accumulation had to accelerate to protect the Chinese economy from looming turmoil. Through state-owned banks and media wires, the citizenry were stimulated to diversify savings into physical gold. Currently, at Chinese banks, numerous gold saving programs can be entered into, or individuals can open an SGI account and purchase gold directly in the wholesale market. Individual investment demand is an important component of China's gold reserve system. Practice shows that gold possession by citizens is an effective supplement to official reserves and is essential for our national financial security. When the gold price came down sharply in April 2013, Chinese gold demand literally exploded as in a once-in-a-lifetime event. And between 22 and the 26th of April, 117 tons of physical gold were withdrawn from the vaults of the SGI. China has been a gigantic gold buyer ever since. Withdrawals from the vaults of the SGI in 2015 accounted for 2,596 tons, 90% of global annual mine output, up from a mere 16 tons in 2002. SGI withdrawal data correlates with elevated gold import by China. Whilst clearly enjoying their bargain purchases, China has established a trend of increasingly obfuscating the true size of its gold demand. Not long ago, several reports were released in the mainland that disclosed total gold demand to be the equivalent to SGI withdrawals. Since 2012, these reports have been hidden from public eyes, and in January 2016 the SGI ceased publishing withdrawal data. 10. Although annual SGI withdrawals have exceeded 2,100 tons since 2013, what is generally publicized as gold demand is roughly half of this. merely the demand at jewelry shops and banks that excludes direct purchases from individual and institutional clients at the SGI. As a result, the global consensus is that Chinese gold demand is approximately 1,000 tons a year, though in reality it's twice this volume. Bach accumulating gold to support renminbi internationalization. To free itself from US dollar supremacy and force the sequent monetary system, China's goal is to internationalize the renminbi. For achieving its target, gold is identified as a key. It is the absolute monetary asset to support the renminbi, the dollar's Achilles heel and the hedge during monetary stress. Next to the swift progression in the Chinese private gold market, we can observe that Bach is covertly buying gold and has launched the Shanghai International Gold Exchange to prepare renminbi internationalization. For China, the strategic mission of gold lies in the support of renminbi internationalization, and so let China become a world economic power. Gold is both a very honest asset and forms the very material basis for modern fiat currencies. Gold is the world's only monetary asset that has no counterparty risk, and is the only cross-nation, cross-language, and cross-culture globally recognized monetary asset. That is why in order for gold to fulfill its destined mission, we must raise our gold holdings a great deal, and do so with a solid plan. Step 1 should take us to the 4,000 tons mark, more than Germany, and become number 2 in the world. Next, we should increase step by step towards 8,500 tons, more than the US. Not surprisingly, China's strategy is everything but linear. Let us analyze the State Council's most recent actions with respect to gold and the internationalization of the renminbi. In addition to gold accumulation, the State Council has aimed to kickstart renminbi internationalization by having it included into the International Monetary Fund's IMF basket of currencies, the Special Drawing Rights (SDR), in 2015. For acceptance, the IMF required openness of China's international reserves, of which the Bach hadn't updated its gold reserves since 2009. Here we found that Bach stretched between opposing forces. It obviously preferred to hoard gold in concealment not to disturb financial markets, while at the same time it was requested to open its books. In July 2015, the Bach decided to revise its official gold reserves by 604 tons to 1,658 tons, which was probably not the whole truth but served both means. As markets barely reacted to the increment, the gold price has not increased since then, and the IMF has granted annexation of the renminbi into the SDR. How much gold does the Bach truly hold? Before we make an estimate, we must first address the question, how and where does the Bach buy gold? Some analysts assume the Bach buys gold in the domestic market at the SGI. According to my research, this is not true. My sources in the bullion industry tell me firsthand that the Bach buys gold in the international lock market using Chinese banks as proxies. And this intelligence fits into the wider analysis, as there are many reasons why the Bach would not buy gold through the SGI. A rough estimate suggests the Bach holds nearly 4,000 tons in gold reserves, more than twice the amount they officially disclose. In a quest for any clues, we must visit the heart of the gold wholesale market. Data by the London Bullion Market Association points out there have been approximately 1,700 tons of monetary gold exported from London between 2011 and 2015. China's central bank is the foremost suspect for these purchases, given its size and motives, and the tonnage exported from London is consistent with other sources that state the Bach has bought roughly 500 tons a year since 2009. All clues together point to the Bach holding roughly 4,000 tons currently. Although this remains speculation, more of China's gold strategy was revealed by the recent launch of the Shanghai International Gold Exchange (SGI) that offers gold trading in renminbi for clients worldwide, in an attempt by China to strengthen the internationalization of the renminbi. In itself, the SGI clearly underlines China's gold ambition 16, but the punchline was added with the launch of the Silk Road Gold Fund in 201517. Led by the SGI, the $16 billion fund will boost the gold industry along the Silk Road and in turn will facilitate gold purchases for the central banks of member states to increase their holdings of the precious metal, according to the Chinese state press agency Xinhua 18. Not only is China trying to persuade all mining and consumption of gold along the Silk Road economic project to be settled through the SGI and renminbi, additionally the Chinese promote gold as an essential component of central banks' international reserves going forward. We must conclude that the State Council views gold as part of the coming international monetary system. Why else does it quickly develop the domestic gold market to be embedded in financial markets, surreptitiously accumulate vast gold reserves, and establish a framework to boost gold business on the Eurasian continent around the SGA? In my view, China contributes significant value to its gold strategy in the shadow of the apparent failure of the current fiat monetary system. And if true, China's central bank having nearly 4,000 tons of gold is well on its way to introduce the next phase. Thanks for watching. Rapprochement is a potential apple of discord between Beijing and Moscow. The researcher points to the fact that the countries would rather create a mutually beneficial triple alliance, a future cornerstone of a unified Eurasia. We're seeing the emergence of a true Eurasian golden triangle with China, Russia and Iran as the three key points, Engdahl underscores. With a stated plan to route the Silk Road rail infrastructure to assist the mining of new gold for currency backing of the Eurasian member states, including now Iran with its significant own unexploited gold, the hyperinflated, debt-bloated dollar system is gaining a formidable positive alternative, one committed to peace and development. China embraces gold in advance of post-dollar era. To challenge the US dollar hegemony and inclinations with Iran, Hussein noted in his article for The Nation, the Pakistani media outlet. Hussein views Pakistan as a geographical corridor between China and Iran. The China-Pakistan Economic Corridor (PEC) project has become more vital after latest trade accords between Iran and China, he underscored. The Pakistani columnist highlighted Russia's determining role in the region and expressed his confidence that China, Pakistan, Iran and Russia will bolster trade and economic growth in Central Asia and beyond. Referring to the fact that Iran currently has SCO observer status, Engdahl envisages that Iran will be formally admitted as a full member of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization (SCO) at their next annual meeting this summer. In contrast to those experts who regard the recent Sino-Iranian TIN agreements on economic and technological cooperation. Furthermore, the leaders announced they will cooperate on the China-led One Belt One Road initiative. The researcher calls the formal inclusion of Iran into China's new economic Silk Road project a giant positive step. According to Engdahl, it will allow Tehran to break years of economic isolation and will open doors to the region's economic development. Pakistani columnist Afzal Hussain echoes Engdahl's stance. The lifting of economic sanctions from Iran provides trade opportunities for regional countries such as Pakistan, Afghanistan, China, Russia, and Central Asian countries, particularly Tajikistan. The trade activity will generate billions of dollars not only for oil-rich Iran, but also for the countries having close economic ties emerging with China, Russia and Iran as the three key points, F. William Engdahl notes. The latest Sino-Iranian rapprochement has prompted a lively debate regarding the new Eurasian world order. Sometimes profound tectonic shifts in the global politics arise from the least noticed events. Such is the situation with Iran and the recent visit to Tehran of China's President-elect Xi Jinping. What emerged from the talks confirms that the vital third leg of what will become a genuine Eurasian golden triangle, of nations committed to peaceful economic development, is now in place. American-German researcher, historian and strategic risk consultant F. William Engdahl writes in his article for New Eastern Outlook. Chinese President-elect Xi Jinping and his Iranian counterpart Hassan Rouhani signed almost 7Special Reports is a daily show that will cover issues surrounding the economic collapse. All our reports and daily alert news are backed up by source links. We work very hard to bring you the facts, and we research everything before presenting the report. Subscribe for latest on financial crisis, oil price, global economic collapse, dollar collapse, gold, silver, Bitcoin, global reset, new world order, economic collapse, economic news, political, geopolitical news. Today, we talk about China, Russia and Iran planning gold-backed currency. A Eurasian golden triangle.